Good morning, everyone. It's a nice brisk morning, isn't it? Not quite as cold as yesterday, but cold nonetheless. In Song of Songs, chapter 5, verse 15, it says, "He is steadfast in all he does. His ways are the ways of righteousness, based on truth and holiness. None can rival him, but all will be amazed by him." Just some thoughts about that. Jesus doesn't waver under pressure. He's steady and constant, stable and reliable, and everything he does is based on purity, holiness, and truth. His ways are always executed with strength and dignity. He does not fail. The dependable ways of our King are like marble pillars established upon a foundation of righteousness. There is no other in heaven or on earth who compares. He relentlessly pursues you because he loves you and he knows you need him. Nothing you can do will ever make him change his mind about you. He is constant. His wholehearted dedication to you is unreserved. His judgment upon your life is without fault and led by mercy. He is the rock of ages, the strength of your life forever. Amen. Amen. Let's just pray. Father, we want to be amazed by you. We want to be like you, constant in compassion, relentless in our pursuit of you and unshakable in our faith. Thank you for your commitment to us, for the way you tirelessly encourage us, for the way you meet us where we're at, and for celebrating even our smallest victory. Thank you that you're our biggest encourager. Your strength has become our foundation and source of joy. We worship you and we honor you. Let's sing to our King.
And Father, we thank you that we have this opportunity to meet together this morning and worship you. We pray that the meditations of our heart, the thoughts of our minds, bring glory to you this morning. Amen. Welcome. Isn't it a good day? Oh, I think it's a good day. That's it. Beautiful. Yeah. Don't mind my nose. It's GP got into me. You get that. Welcome, boys. Well, I got a few aides, that's good. And officers. And families. It's good to have you here with us. Don't forget, after the service, we'll have a morning tea at the back. Come and share in that time with us. Carol's been cooking up a storm. It's good. Tell them Davo's birthday on Tuesday. It's Denise's birthday on Wednesday. And it's Chris Carr's birthday on Wednesday. Happy birthday. Can't hear you.
That was Tony's birthday Thursday.
So we've got the usual activities this week. Thank you. Usual activities during the week. See the bulletin for everything that's going on. Don't forget, Connect Group starts at 10 o'clock, not 9:30, for the next couple of weeks before school holidays. School holidays coming up. Isn't that good, kids? Yes. Got a response for that one. Rhys and Janet and Jackie are going on holidays as of this Friday.
Yeah.
So if you've got any pastoral matters while they're away, catch up with one of the elders and we can sort that out. Next Sunday, what's on? Members meeting. Excellent. That's good. You're welcome to join in that time with the members next Sunday after the service. Just a reminder for offerings, we've got a couple of boxes, a box out the front and a box out the back. If you bring offerings and tithes on a Sunday morning, or we encourage online giving as well. You may remember last week we met a new couple, Eric and Jemima. They're a couple of missionaries on their way from Adelaide to North Queensland to do some missionary work with the Aboriginal communities up there. Their motorhome broke down outside Maribyrnong. So they're trying to raise money at the moment to fund the repairs for that. They're chasing about 10 grand. They do yard work and stuff like that. So if you want some work done, we've got a contact number for them on the board out there. But they're also needing a car with a tow bar to borrow for the next couple of weeks. They have been able to borrow someone's car up to now, but they need another one for the next few weeks. So if you're able to help them with that, let us know and we'll get you in touch with them around that. So Lord, be with each of us today, we pray. In your name, amen.
Okay, we're going to do a little item, we might say, for the boys to present to the church. I will warn you now, there may be some need for involvement from the congregation as well. So I'll just give you that warning now.
And just letting you know, this is like, we're just setting the scene that it's a normal boys brigade, like they're on parade, okay? So it's just a normal night, and then all of a sudden we hear a woman's voice. You didn't do your room. Your grades are terrible. You treat us with no respect. There will be no boys brigade for you. Come now. Malachi and Joshua, come. And actually, this was just the start. Every couple of weeks, there was something else that happened. One week, Officer David was talking to Cole.
Oh, I got a new job. I got to go to NASA. So.
Oh, no. And you're going to take your boys
take
with
two
you?
Two boys. God. And they leave. And it slows down. Another week goes by. And then two boys get sick and start getting really sick. And they leave, and they don't come back. And a couple of officers got worked. They had to go to work. They got reassigned. So yeah. They move. You can do, yeah.
Gotta go to work.
And another officer decided that he had to leave for family commitments. And then Matthew.
Oh, I've got too many school commitments. I can't
too
go.
Much, too much school?
Yeah.
Like, look what it's done to us.
And as you can see, this is how Boys Brigade starts to go slowly. And then we had the chaplains who could see there was not much work here.
Our people have lost like sheep, they've strayed. I pray that they are all well and that they are in God's care. Lord, I pray for each and every one who have gone away. Should have bought my glasses. keep them safe by night and day. Why don't we just pray for each one and ask them to come back? Lord, it was great when we used to read the Bible together in Boys Brigade and learn all the Bible's principles, learning to read a map, follow a compass, hike and paddle a kayak and canoe. And it was wonderful when we're all together learning from the Bible. Lord, help us get the boys back.
If there's this a number, I may as well go and do another roadie.
Yeah.
So I'm off too.
They're off. The captain's go and sit down.
Lance, what are we going to do?
Well,
I think we should pray.
Okay.
Dear Lord, help us to find more boys to come for Boys Brigade, to learn more about you and to learn more about life. In your name, amen.
Then Caleb goes and sits down. He's very lonely. He's all by himself. And he's thinking and thinking. And then he remembers a verse the pastor told him. Matthew 18, verse 19 to 20.
Again, I tell you that if two of you on earth agree about anything you ask for, it will be done for you. My Father in heaven, for there two or three come together in my name, there am I with them.
So Caleb stands with the chaplains and they stand there and they start to pray that the boys come back. They join hands and pray. And then they start planting a seed and they go forth. And each one goes and brings someone new.
Go and get someone back. Bring somebody back. You go and find somebody. Yeah. Let's get the boys back, hey? welcome back, Reuben. Wow.
And the captain. The captain can stand up too.
Bring somebody back.
He got
see
back.
If we can bring
he got them. Back.
Got back. Yeah.
So they join hands and they pray for the next week and see what happens.
Dear Lord, we were short on numbers and we thank you for answering prayer that these boys have come back. And we just pray that you may continue to bring the boys back to us and, Lord, that we find some new boys as well. So we'll send these boys out again to see who they can get back to Brigade.
So the boys go and get a friend and next week they bring him. And the pastor and the chaplains, the captain and the chaplains, decide it was time to get the church involved. So they got the pastor and some deacons and brought them out as well. Yeah. And officers, yes. You're going back. So they all stood there that next another week and prayed for the next week to see what we could come up with.
Father, we're so grateful that you are faithful. And look at these fine young men who've come together. We bless them in Jesus' name. And our heart is, God, that others would gather together that can also be blessed in Jesus' name, that can make mates and friendships, that together we can find that two or three gathering where you are in our midst, and that is enough. For we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
So the next week, They all go out and they grab someone new. And the chaplains and pastors lined up and brought the church in and involved the church. But we're not all going to come down the front. We wouldn't fit. So if you could please stand up, would be nice, and join us. And this is the way a church and a family grows, well, I think, with God's help, God's direction. So I'd like to say one last prayer, and Caleb will finish it for me. Dear God, thank you for all you do for us. Please give us the courage and faith as we step out and plant the seed to bring more to your family. Let us prepare the way for them and be ready to share your love.
This is good. This is God's family and our family.
Thank you. Now we're going to do a little song. You can stay standing and do the directions with us if you'd like.
Jesus changes lives forever. If he calls, I won't say never. I'll say now. Use me, Lord, somehow. He's at work every minute. His great plan, I am in it. I'll say now. Use me, Lord, somehow. With all
with a thousand hallelujahs.
Oh, the goodness, the goodness of Jesus.
Well, good day. How we going? How we going, boys? Good to see you. Families and friends, welcome. My name's Rhys. Look forward to having a cup of tea with you a bit later. That'll be great. Yeah, so last time we were together, who can tell me what I actually painted, what we talked about? Yes. The treasure of pearls. And who was the pearl? No. Who was the pearl? Me. That's exactly right. Now, that was one half of two stories that Jesus told. And it's interesting that he began talking about the kingdom of God and the way that place that works where God is king by talking about pearls. You see, for the Jews, a pearl was an unclean thing. It was not acceptable to them. So what Jesus was saying was that the you are the outsiders, like us are to the Jews. That God loves, that he invested his only son to bring us into relationship with him and into the wonder and mystery of what it means to belong to him. That was the second story. I actually started back the front. I want to read this passage to you out of Matthew 13 as we come to have a conversation today. Jesus speaking, he said, "The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure that a man discovered hidden in a field. In his excitement..." Actually, in his joy, he hid it again and sold everything he owned to get enough money to buy the field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant on the lookout for choice pearls. When he discovered a pearl of great price, he sold everything he owned and bought it. So two stories sound very, very similar, but the second one was about the outsiders. The first one was actually about the Jewish people. And it's a fascinating thing that God sees his people as a treasure. I reckon that's pretty cool. So, boys, help me understand then, what does it mean? What is it that brings you joy? Because what brings God joy are those who are a part of his family and those who are becoming a part of his family. But what is it that brings you joy? Don't be shy. Don't stick up your hand. Just tell me. Who likes Maccas? Yeah, thanks, Robin. A few of us do. Yeah? Does that bring you joy when you go to Macca's? Huh? When you go to Macca's, does that make you a hamburger? Uh-uh. Just like going to church doesn't make you a follower of Jesus, eh? What else brings you joy? Come on, boys, let's go. Tell me what brings you joy. What makes you joyful? What makes you happy? Don't be shy. I'm going to be filling this out just a little bit, so don't be shy. Come on. Sorry? God makes you happy. Cool. Yeah, God's pretty cool. What else makes you happy? Hang on. Playing soccer. Ah, yeah. Brings a lot of joy. Brings a lot. And part of the bringing of joy is actually, it's pretty hard to play soccer on your own, isn't it? Huh? You know, pretty hard. And isn't it interesting that in the skit that we presented, the item we presented a little earlier, that Caleb was stuck for a moment all on his own. Hey Caleb, was that a lot of fun on your own? Wasn't really cool, wasn't it? Huh? Yeah. I mean, look, some of us are introverts and we like our own space and we kind of do our thing. I remember when our son and daughter Luke and Esther, when they were little, and if Luke, well, sometimes we'd need to help them encourage. I didn't really like placing the hand of correction on the hand of justice on the seat of correction, but we'd send Luke to his room. He loved that because he was an introvert. He'd sit down in his room and he'd pull out a book, and he was Esther. She wouldn't even be in her room and she'd say, "Can I come out yet? Can I come out yet?" I mean, Esther's probably as extroverted as a father. It's a scary thought. What do you reckon, C? Is that fair dinkum? I remember, Celia, when you were doing the Sunday school stuff at Woodridge, you always had the Esther factor. Like anything that could go wrong would, and she was in the middle of it. Fascinating. Okay, come on, boys. What else? Come on, some of you adults. What else brings you joy? Sorry? Opening presents. Yeah, look, you know, presents are pretty cool. Presents are pretty cool. But you know what makes a present even cooler? Can I give you a tip? Fellas, don't ever do this. One year I bought Jackie 2 really big fishing reels for Christmas. You know, like, buy your wife a whipper snipper. Not. Okay? What makes gifts really cool is, and Jackie's gone to Brisbane this weekend, helping us to get ready for Kevin's birthday next week. And she took down some gifts, and there was a really cool... Kevin's 3, and he's into bugs big time. So she bought him a bug catcher, and she bought him a net, and, you know, and just... Because the gift, the treasure, is appropriate to him. And he's going to have an absolute hoot. And so... We'll be going down next weekend to Brisbane to celebrate Kevin's 3rd birthday, which will be very nice. But when you start thinking about gifts and treasure, I mean, there's really no point in kind of, if it doesn't relate to you, if it's not like, you know, give your wife a chainsaw for Christmas. You know what I mean? It's not really cool. But I tell you what, and I should have, because I'm a police chaplain as well. And when I go into the stations, I actually take red frogs. I tell you what, policemen and women, they love red frogs. okay? It's a really good bribery. And if they're not at their desks, I'll very often leave a red frog for them, because I know that it makes them happy. I know that it's part of, you know, when people are recognised for their service, and it's really tough for our policemen and women, but there's a real sense of joy. And isn't it interesting in the story, in the first story, where a man, he bought a field. Now, it might seem strange to you that someone would have a treasure buried in a field. That might seem a little bit strange. But back in the day that Jesus was living, they didn't have banks. They didn't have safety deposit boxes. They didn't have those sorts of places. Actually, on this treasure, let me put a sapphire. What do you reckon? Is that pretty cool? A sapphire? There's a sapphire in that treasure. I wonder, in that treasure, what else is there? I reckon. Oh, my red needs some water. So we're talking about a ruby. Who here has had a ruby wedding anniversary? Got a few? How many is that? About 40? 40? I reckon 40. Yeah, Jackie and I got two to go for our ruby. Can't wait for it, because I absolutely love rubies. No, that's not a snow cone. That's actually a ruby. Love rubies. So we've got a sapphire. What else do we? I reckon. We're going really well this morning. So let's see. Oh, our sapphire's bled a little bit, but that's okay. So let's see. Let's go for a nice kind of big emerald, because I like emeralds, and they kind of have multifaceted faces, sort of like that, sort of emerald. And what else is there? What are we missing? So we're missing the crown of them all, the diamond. There we go. We'll put him in there. And, oh, look, let's not forget, because in the ancient world, one of the most precious, as we see in the next story, was a pearl. And a black pearl is the most precious of all. So all of these treasures, all of these very rich things combined to be a treasure that was buried. And the reason they buried them, as I was saying, when marauders and raiders and bandits would come, there was nowhere for people to hide their precious things. So they'd dig a hole in their field and bury it. And so this fellow, he was going out to buy a field, and he went out and he surveyed it. And when the Jews surveyed their real estate options, they were very astute. They knew every blade of grass. They knew everything that was on there. And this guy, as he was doing his searches, he discovers, wow, a treasure. That's pretty cool. And it gave him so much joy that he sold everything he had to buy this field for the treasure that was in the field. And of course, the treasure, like the pearl, is you. Because God the Father gave everything he could to remove what is wrong, to restore what is right, that you, we, us can have relationship with him. What an amazing privilege that we have. It's quite fascinating. And this treasure, so valuable. I haven't always been a pastor. Let me give you a little bit of background. At one point in time, I used to help people buy new cars, not used ones. You can never trust a horse salesman, but new ones. Everyone had the same pony. And so they were backed with warranty. I could go to the table and I helped people purchase these cars. One day, I was at Q Ford down south of Logan at Springwood there. And this fellow walked in, wanted to buy a new TX5 Ford sedan, like hatchback thing. And he walks in and he's got a bag. Now, this is back in the day where you didn't have a $1 coin, a $2 coin. They had notes. And this guy starts pulling out these notes out of this duffel bag, $1 notes. $2 notes. That was when cars were sort of $3,500. I mean, that was, and he pulled out the cash, and as I unrolled it, where do you reckon it had been? Where? No, not in the backyard. Under the bed. This bloke didn't trust banks. He buried all his money under his mattress, and didn't it smell like it? And I know someone that inherited their uncle's bed, and she was none too impressed until she actually, there was a zipper in the mattress. And curiosity killed the cat. She opened it, it was full of money. That gave her a lot of joy. So this thing, this treasure that this man found, it actually gave him so much joy. Because you see, it's quite interesting when you think about this. And we need to understand that real joy, true joy, doesn't kind of just happen out there on its own. Oh, yeah, I feel a bit of joy today. You know, I'm feeling it today. The sort of joy that Jesus is talking about is very much see what I did there? Not much of an artist, but I think you get the message. The joy is linked to the treasure. And that's you. It's more than just Maccas. And it's more than just playing soccer. It's more. It's way, way more. This joy of relationship with God that he invested into so much. There was, how much more can anyone give than their own son? There's nothing more. When God said, I love you, he stretched out his arms and died. He gave himself to remove what is wrong, to restore what is right. You see, Hebrews 10 and verse 2 says that Jesus, for the joy that was set before him, he actually endured the cross. And the joy that was set before him was you and me. He couldn't stand heaven without you, so he broke heaven in on earth as it is in heaven. He actually opens a doorway. This isn't about religion. This is not an issue of religion. It is a fundamental of relationship, of friendship. It's an expression of outrageous love that is linked inseparably to the treasure, to you, to me. This is the amazing story that Jesus is telling to these people. And so then I suppose the next thing we need to kind of think about is, okay, what does that mean to me? How then should I respond? And as you saw, for some of you would have read the notes on the newsletter today. And I'm not such a the way religion bangs on and talks about obedience is really awkward, because I've heard it too often, you know, referred to as a whipping post. But what this outrageous gift of love, it invites us to invest time, to reprioritize ourselves. I mean, 38 years ago, I got 2 years to go before we get our ruby wedding, Celia, two more to go, but we're going to get there. We've earned the right to grow old and wrinkly together. I continually remind Jackie of that. She goes, "Doh." But, you know, when Jackie and I first met, we wouldn't have had a relationship if I didn't prioritize my time to get to know her. And it's like that with God. That it's not that we sacrifice time, but rather our joy in response to his joy is to invest the time to get to know him, to read the scriptures, to meet with others and kick those ideas around, to gather together with others that love him in corporate worship like today. So, and all of that takes time. All that takes an investment of time. But it just doesn't stop there. It actually, when we realize what it is that God has done for us in the person of Jesus, our reasonable response is that we actually want to get over ourselves and become like him. And so it's we give ourselves to being trained. I'm not thinking about, you know, the light in the front of something that's coming through the tunnel to iron you out in the other end. I'm not thinking about that. But rather, and it's not about saying, you might remember, and some of the older ones might remember the statement of, what would Jesus do? I don't know. I'm not him. I got to work out what I'm going to do. And I've lived my life before I met Jesus very selfishly. I weighed everything up in terms of what it meant for me. If it was good for me, even if it was at your expense, it was good. You know what I'm saying? And so there's this idea of, I've got to get over myself. I've got to learn about justice and being just, you know, treating others fairly. Boys, it's like when you go to preschool or school, Maddie, for some of you older ones, looking around for the kid that's been left out and taking your lunch and going over, and he might not have any, but going over and saying, "Hey, can I share my banana with you? Maybe. Yeah. Well, if you, you know, I got a Vegemite and cheese sandwich. Would you like half? You know, we treat others with mercy. We've got to learn about that stuff. We treat others with compassion. Like we stand with them in their tears, not to fix their problem, but crying with them, taking away that sense of being alone, Caleb. None of us want to be alone. Being lovingly kind, random acts of kindness. Back in my day, it was kind of like getting the little bottle of milk with the lid and giving it to my friend. We don't do that anymore, do we? Darn shame. But, you know, this idea of being faithful. So being just, being merciful, being lovingly kind, being compassionate, being faithful. We've got to learn that stuff. And the only way we do it is by reflecting and hanging out with Jesus, reflecting on his word to see where his character is expressed. And rather than saying, what would Jesus do? It's what would Sharon do? What would Josh do? What would Phil do? How can Celia be mercifully kind and just and faithful? How can I be that? Rather than saying, what would Jesus do? I ain't him. What am I going to do? And how am I going to respond to the promptings that the Spirit gives? And that takes us to be trained. We've got to invest. And it's not an obedience kind of dutiful thing. It's actually a joy. It's a joy. But it doesn't stop just with investment of time and putting effort into our training. But rather, I got another T word, won't surprise you. So one of the boys said earlier that soccer, I reckon he might actually have a bit of a, might be quite good at it. And, you know, I guess when you start thinking about how we are, how we do respond to this one in joy, with the wonderful love that we've received, is about what we do with our talents, what we're good at, what we're passionate for. And there's a pretty fair indication that the things that you are passionate about is something that God has placed in your heart to contribute into the lives of others. Where is your passion? What is your talent? Now, some people will talk about spiritual gift, and there's a thing about that as well. But what do you really like? Do you like soccer? Well, you play soccer to the glory of God. What is it that floats your boat? What is it that toots your horn? I know for me, I love going fishing. Who likes fishing? I like fishing, yeah. And there's nothing like getting a few blokes out in the boat and, you know, you hook up into a fish and one bloke will say, look, you know, when you get that thing in the boat, you'll need to check the use-by date to see if it's gone off, you know. Oh, that thing's going to have maggots on it by the time it comes in the boat. And then you have these small windows where these blokes in the 4x4 space or 4x2 space in the back of a boat, oh, look, I'm struggling a little bit with my daughter. Having a bit of trouble to work out how I can relate meaningfully to my wife. You know, we've got a family member that's doing life tough. And all of a sudden, the fishing becomes the means. The soccer becomes the means. The Maccas becomes the means. Are you hearing this? As we give our talents, as we invest our talents into a joy response. Now, I got another T here. But you know, for the life of me, I can't remember what it was. Like I said, I'd said to the leaders through the week, I got stuff falling through my brain quicker than it's going in. I know I need a holiday. time, train, talent. Ah, what was that? What was that? You see, that's why we need each other. Like, Boys Brigade, boys, you do this really... Gee, I'm so glad I am with my people. You people save my butt so often. Seriously. You see, Caleb, wasn't it terrible when you were here on your own? It was shocking. And there are meant to be no lone ranger followers of Jesus. But do you know the beauty about team? Here you go. Together. T. Another T. Right. Each. T. E. Achieves. A. More. I am more because I am with you. You cover my back. I am no longer alone. When you guys do drill, don't be mistaken. It's not about doing this. It's not about that. It's actually about together. It's about together. And church, it's not about Barnsley coming and having a time of worship and hallelujah, praise the Lord Jesus, you're the greatest. You know? It's not about Jeff coming in, fiddling with the knobs on the sound desk saying, oh yeah, hallelujah, praise the Lord, you know, Jesus is the greatest. It's not about Val sitting up the back praying and saying, well, I'm here to God and hallelujah, praise the Lord, Jesus is the greatest, amen. It's not about Carol and Bevan coming in as a couple alone saying, hallelujah, praise the Lord, Jesus is the greatest, amen. It's not about Scott and Rebecca coming in saying, hallelujah, praise the Lord Jesus, greatest, amen. It's actually team. Together, each achieves more. So when people start talking about counting the cost, it's actually the cost has been paid. And Our privilege, because of the love we've received and the joy that it produces in us, is to then invest our time, invest ourselves into understanding what justice, mercy, compassion, loving kindness, and faithfulness is. Understanding the investment of our talents, not for ourselves, but for others. And understanding that we are part of a team. And therein. And I can honestly tell you that the worst day with Jesus in my life, it beats the best day the way it used to be, hands down. Hands down. A gift of love that brings joy. Let's pray. Jesus, what a privilege it is to be sharing together as a family, as a community. What a privilege it is to welcome these amazing young men together. Here with their families and their friends. That we can share in this rich joy. And even on those days where it's tough, even in those moments where we struggle, yet we still find space for joy. Help us in our responses to prioritize our time, to invest in to being trained. Becoming more like you, choosing not what would Jesus do, but what I'm going to do. Investing our talents for the greater good of all, because together each achieves more. Father, I just thank you for these boys. I thank you for these officers who are investing their time, their training, their talent, their team to support these young men. And I thank you for the mums and the dads and the granddads and grandmums. And thank you for the friends around that are supporting this group that certainly remind us together, each achieves more. For we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
I found a love greater than my fear, so I found a hope.
thanks to our online family for tuning in. We trust today has been an encouragement to you. Thank you to you all for coming and celebrating our parade together today. And we've got morning tea afterwards. Sorry, team online, you're going to miss out. But I hope you can have a donut or something in your privacy, your own home. It's great to have you with us. We're gonna march the colours out with this, you know, this wonderful declaration that we were lost and we've been rescued.
Love came down.